Hello everyone, welcome to the GU Ecologist. So in today's session, we are going to discuss about how to write a field report. So today is the first part of the conclusion of our field work and research methodology in geography. So the first part will be dealing with the tabulation and representation of various data analysis. So now we come to the phase where we have discussed all the basic aspects of conducting a field work. In the field, we go and collect the data and come back and analyze the data and produce a result. And finally, we give a shape to our field report. So today in this session, part one, we are going to discuss about the basics of writing a field report. The basic question in every researcher's mind, in every student's mind is how to write it. So today we are going to discuss in the first part, the basics of writing a field report, especially the representation of data analysis and the tabulation of data analysis. So these are going to be the key features, right? So now let's go further. But before going further, please like and subscribe to the channel and please press the bell icon for the updates. Now, once the data collection is completed, what do we do? The first thing is the accurate, orderly, and rational description. Remember these three words. These three words hold the key: accurate, orderly, and rational description of the field, the study area. So it has to be accurate. It cannot be disfigured or disoriented. Accuracy matters, isn't it? Because it's directly coming from the field. Now, orderliness means a scaling is involved, a sequence is involved, a pattern is involved, right? That's why order is important, and rationality is with the least bias as it can be. So biasness has no scope when we are talking about a basic idea of field research and a report writing. So accurate, orderly, and rational. Remember these three keywords whenever you are making a field report, right? So for various levels of the curriculum, such as undergraduate, postgraduate, and other program of studies like MPhil and PhDs, this is applicable, that it has to be accurate, orderly, and rational in nature. So at MPhil and PhD level, the outcome of the fieldwork has to be complemented with secondary data as well. But at undergraduate level, if it is just a field report, then maximum of the primary data has to be included apart from some secondary sources. Alright, so the focus has to be at undergraduate level on the primary surveys, right? But in MPhil and PhDs, it has to be a balance among the two. So secondary data as well as the primary data collected from the field has to be balanced in an order, right? So final dissertation or thesis, which has to be submitted after fulfilling the various objectives that we have taken in the beginning, isn't it? A research starts with the idea, the objective of what has to be done. So at the end, when we are submitting the report, the dissertation or the thesis has to be clearly stated that it has fulfilled the objectives undertaken at the beginning of the study. So this is the basic idea of writing a report. So whenever we start writing, we must have this concepts and idea about how to write a report. But before that, what is the basic ingredient of writing a report? What is the basic idea behind it? Isn't it? Now, so according to the methodology of field report writing, let's take a reference from University of Adelaide, Australia, a standard reference that what is the basic methodology talking about field report writing, right? So in producing a field report, the researcher or the student normally addresses following questions. So what happens? The field report must answer these questions. The first question is, what did you do? The first question is, what question? What exactly did you do? What was the study undertaken? Then, what question is further added by why question? So, why did you do it? What was the purpose? Why there was a need? So, you have to establish that need when you are writing the report ultimately, isn't it? Then, how did you do it? This is talking about the research methodology that we discussed, isn't it? So, what was the data? How was it collected? What were the methodologies involved? And what were why that particular method was applied for data collection, isn't it? So all those things comes under how you did that work, field work, isn't it? Then what did you find out? It means now we are talking about the results, the analysis of the data that we collected. What was the result all about? Okay, so what were the finding? And what does the findings mean? So findings have nothing to do just with the results that you derive. Just remember, the research doesn't end on just the result that you derive from data analysis. Further, that result has to be interpreted. It means we have to interpret the results in the context of the study, in the context of the study area. Because if we just put the analysis results in statistical format or just the result of the data that we analyzed, it has no meaning. We as a researcher have to give meanings to our findings in the context of the study. So do not stop just after analyzing a data. The result of the data has to be finally interpreted. That's what the last and the fifth point is. So this is the entire methodology of writing a field report. So whenever you're writing a field report, remember to answer these five questions. Okay? Now, so the first basic thing about report writing is that it is different from an essay writing. So do not confuse or do not make that same way that essay writing you're doing, right? Because essay writing is different. The reports normally utilize these primary surveys, primary data than secondary data, right? So that is most important difference. Then they are formally structured. So a report is not just random writing, okay? It has to be a structured format. So formally structured, and the researcher may not necessarily require to develop an argument throughout the report. It's not necessary that you apply argument in every section because it's a formal structure. So every section has its own importance, and then you have to compile it. And remember that addressing the research questions is the main purpose. So what were your research questions in the beginning? That is the main purpose of the study. Alright, so despite this distinction, it's important that most excellent fieldwork, field reports, traverse from the first to the end sections in a linked manner in this particular way. So let's look at that. So introduction is the basic idea, right? Introduction to your research, where you discuss about the details, about the conceptual part of it, and research questions. Then you're talking about the area of research. So geographical profile you must address if you are talking about a particular area where you're going to do the fieldwork, isn't it? Then aims and objectives. So if you're doing your aims and objectives, that it means then you're fixing your work, your goal. Then you're applying the research methodology, completeness, you're discussing it, and then you're applying it, and then you're deriving results and discussions. And then finally you're writing the summary and conclusion. So this is a basic structure. But remember, the basic structure has to be provided with certain in-between points. For example, in-between points like geographical profile of study area will have to have the entire physical and human geography in the context of the study, isn't it? But before aims and objectives, we also must go through all the literature that is available. So then you must consult all the literature that is available, isn't it? Otherwise, how will you fix your aims and objectives? So that is in between. But this is the basic excellent structure that you can think of writing any basic field report, right? And you can further improvise. That we'll see that how you can improvise upon this basic structure. So this basic structure has to be improvised further. So basic introduction, study area, aims and objectives, research methodology, results, discussions, and summary. This is a basic structure, and you have to build your building on this basic structure of the report. Okay, so you have to add, you have to change the title, subtitles, you can do whatever you want on this basic structure. So remember this basic structure, which is important here. Okay, now objectives. So objectives are important because you must mention it in a given priority, in a format. So how to write your objectives? So I'll tell you a simple way to understand how an objective is written. So if we have a study and its main objectives have to be listed, so it has to be listed in this particular way. For example, the first objective has to be regarding the identification, the what question. Remember the questions? So what, how, why? So the first question is what. So the identification of the study context is important. Identification of the research problem is important. So first objective has to start from the identification. So what you can write is, the objectives of the study are to identify such and such problem in a given area, right? Then the second can be assessment. Now comes the how and why wala part. Remember? So identification, then assessment. So to identify, then to assess such and such problem, then to analyze. So third is the last section of analysis of what you're assessing. So assessment is you're going to the field, collecting data in a particular method you're applying, and then you're bringing back, and then you're analyzing it, isn't it? So third step is analysis, and fourth step is formulation of different strategies, suggestions on the basis of the first three steps. So this is a sequence that you need to follow, and if you don't find any other word, you can use this method to prepare any research proposal in terms of your MPhil or your PhD or any research proposal at any level. The basic objectives can always be listed in this manner. The manner of to identify such and such problem, to assess such and such problem, to analyze such and such problem, and to formulate strategies based on the identification, assessment and analysis. Isn't it? So this is how we state our objectives while writing a report. Remember to write your report with a focus on these keywords of the objectives. So your objectives must have these identification, assessment, analysis and formulation words for that matter. Even if they are not words, it must be part of your objectives. Alright, now research methodology chart or a flow diagram is one of the most important aspects when we are writing a report finally. Why? Because for a reader, a neutral person who doesn't know what you're doing, what you have done in your work, this one chart can summarize it for him, that what is the flow of your work. So you have to represent it in a very clearly stated manner in a flow diagram, in a flow chart, isn't it? For example, this is an example of a flow chart. So it is one of the examples. You can design your own. So a research methodology will have primary data and secondary data, which will be clearly defined in terms of what are the ingredients of your primary data, where are you collecting it from, and then secondary data sources, then how are you analyzing it, and then how are you proceeding further till summary and conclusion. So this is the basic idea of a flow diagram that is important when we are writing it finally. Okay, so in written format of the report, this must come into the picture before finally giving the results and conclusion. So you must write it in the beginning of the chapter, that what is your research methodology chart. Just after your objectives, you must give your research methodology, because your objectives are going to be fulfilled by this entire chart in this particular flow. So making such a chart gives a good impression to any reader. Any tutor, mentor would recommend you to make this kind of chart for a proper research based analysis and report writing. Alright, now data tabulation and representation, the first major part of today's session. So how to tabulate a data, what is the best method, what are its advantages, and how to represent that. That's the important point of writing a report finally. Data collection is not enough. How to tabulate it, how to analyze it, and then represent it is the main crux of the matter, because that is what is going to matter at the end of the day. So remember, focus on the points that we are talking in this section of data tabulation and representation. So while tabulation the data, important point must be taken into consideration. First point, a table must have an appropriate title at the top and source at the bottom. Okay, remember this point for any table, anywhere that you make. A table cannot be titleless. So whatever you're making in the table, you're providing the information in the table, must be having a particular title at the top in a bold format or in a given format, that whatever is prescribed to you. But the format must remain uniform throughout. So remember, select a format and always post a title on the top and source at the bottom of the table. So if it is a primary survey based source, then simply write primary survey such and such year. Primary survey, comma, year. Don't write collected by the author, written by the author, done by the researcher. No. Just write primary survey, comma, 2020, 25, whatever you want to write in whichever you have collected the data. So remember, just a title at the top and source at the bottom is the basic idea of the representation of a table. Then further numbering is mandatory. So one table has to have an ID of its own, isn't it? If you are having 30 tables, suppose you have made 30 tables from your questionnaire survey, then you cannot have this distinguish factor between all those tables without a number. So number is the identity. So suppose the table is in the first chapter, right? So first chapters, first table would be 1.1, that is the standard format. So for example, table 1.1 is for the first chapter, first table. 1.2 is for the first chapter, second table. Similarly for second chapter, first table, 2.1. So remember, that is a standard format of a report writing in terms of table representation. Always identify your table with a particular number, including the chapter number at the first, and then with the table number. So table 1.1 means first table in the first chapter. Okay, so remember that. Then units of measurement and data representation must be clearly written. Many a times people miss this. They don't understand that it's not a very much a good idea to leave your data just like any numbers, just in the form of numbers. Units of measurements must be specified, because that will give a meaning to what you are trying to say through your data analysis, isn't it? So units of measurement is important, and it should be throughout. It should be very uniform throughout. Somewhere you have measured it into miles and somewhere into kilometers. If there is a particular distance, that's not fair. Either use inch mile system or centimeter kilometer system. A standard format must be applied to units of measurement and representation of data. All right. Now, in case of abbreviations that you use, if you're using an abbreviation, you must state it in a footnote section, or at the beginning you must add a page in which you can mention it, the entire abbreviations, acronyms, whatever you have used in this entire report further, so a person can refer to it. Okay, and the best idea is to always quote that particular abbreviation in the paragraph. Okay, that you must state it. If suppose you are using USGS, United States Geological Survey, you must state it somewhere for the reader to understand what is USGS. Right, now it enables, the advantage is that it enables a comprehensive data reading for a researcher. If you have a comprehensive approach basically means easy to comprehend, easy to understand. So if it is a comprehensive data reading method, that is only through good tabulation. So that is one advantage. Then it fosters quick comparison between the variables. Suppose I have to compare the variables, a good table would help me out to do it in a very fast manner. That's why tabulation is important in a better manner, right? It helps to detect errors and omissions as well. You can find the missing numbers many a times, isn't it, through tables. Now, it precisely gives us the overall characteristics of the collected data. So good table representation is important for this research part, the representation part, because this will give a reader the overall characteristics of the data collected and its analysis done. That's why tabulation plays a vital role. And then further, tables have to be simple, or cross tables you can make for comparison, right? Mapping is important part of writing a report. So mapping on the basis of GIS software that we talked in the last session, isn't it, in the methods part. So use your GIS software, and always remember scale calculation through PACE surveys if you have done in the field, or compass, GPS points and tracks. It can be utilized to make a good representative map of the problem that you're stating. A general map doesn't serve the purpose of a field report, remember. General map will only address the general problem, but field report is very specific. So don't make generalizations of maps. Make it to the point, to the specific thing that you have done in the field. A map must be very specific. All right. Now, graphical representation becomes very much important. Bar graphs, line graphs, star graphs, web graphs, you have so many options on the Word format if you are working. So you can use any particular format depending upon what your data is. Alright, so you should have it numbered as well. Again, the identity matters, and graphical representations will be like, you have already discussed the tabular representations, so table 1.1, now it will be figure, because it's a graph, graphical representations. So it can be figure 2.1, figure 2.2, certainly the identity has to be very clear of which chapter, which figure you are talking about, right? So it must have a title and source again. So either it is a graph or it is a table, it must have a title and source. Remember, do not forget to put the title and the source. If it is secondary data, secondary source. If it is primary data, write primary survey and the year. Okay, don't write, again I'll repeat, don't write collected by the researcher or analyzed by the author. Don't write anything like that. Just write primary survey. All right. Now, diagrammatic representation, for example, flow diagram, hierarchy, process, cyclic, pyramid, matrix, many types of diagrams are available, but you must understand for what kind of representation you want a particular kind of flow. So you must be clear about the analysis, the data. So if you understand your data, you can pick and choose which kind of diagrammatic representation you want. And again, it must have a title and source, as we discussed. Photographs cannot be just simple photographs. Remember, you have to annotate your photographs well. If you are showing something in the photograph, it must be discussed in the paragraph of the writing, as well as it must have a GPS location or a Google Earth location. It must have a coordinate. Okay, photographs cannot be left without any coordinates. So these days it's very easy. If you're carrying a GPS, you can put that GPS location of the particular point of the photograph, and you can must you think that a photograph is something which a person is seeing it, but he is not able to guess the location. So you must specify a location to him. Okay, so that is the best way to actually geotag your pictures. So photographs must have GPS locations or the coordinate points marked on it, with the title and the source obviously. Transcriptions of the recorded interview. So in the field, if you are talking about interviews to people, then those interviews must be transcribed. It must be written exactly the way it was said. Suppose a person in the field says that we don't have any opportunity here in the village for further studies. So if you have recorded it, you must write in the same way that he has said, that the respondent says that there is no opportunity for the higher studies in the village. So exactly it should be written under quotes and in italics. So this is the way you transcribe your recorded interview, right? Sketches made in the field can be scanned and put to use in the form of image. That is important. Now, I'll give you certain illustrations and examples of representation that we have used in field work prior to this session. So I'll give an example. Now, look at this map. This map has a title, all the ingredients of a map, and also it has a detailing of the sources. This map is based on GIS analysis. So what kind of imagery was used, what was the source, what has been represented. So it is very clear to the reader that how this map was made, from what data source, and what does it represent. So map should be very clearly represented, and it should be well quoted in title, and as well as source must be there. Okay, now any table. So this is another example of a table, but what is the title? Stepwise GIS operations for geodiversity assessment. So if you are making an analysis and assessment in which you are using a table, you must give a title, and there must be a flow of all the steps that you have used in GIS. So suppose you are using a GIS operation to make a map. Okay, so how will the reader understand what are the steps? If I want to do the same mapping, how will I learn? So make it easier for the reader by using the step method. Always give the steps of GIS operations when you are using it, and always make the source as prepared by researcher in a given year. Okay, so that is one of the important aspects. Now, this is one of the ways you can represent a multivariate table, okay, where you have lots of variations and you have many factors. So what you can do is you can create a web diagram, okay, and you can write it through primary source. In this, it's very easy to identify what are the majority of factors that influences the title. So suppose here livelihood is the title. So which are the more important factors in livelihood? So which axis is greater? Construction activities, salaried employment. So these are the two major factors in the field area that is very clearly represented through this web diagram. So certain representations can be made in your field work as well. Then these are certain types of pie diagrams. So age structure, educational qualification, medical health facilities, drinking water facilities. You can take any kind of pie and make it very clear with your title and source specific, and also representation of the pie diagram. Alright, now let's look at these photographs. So as we discussed earlier, the title of the photograph, then mark the important identities of photograph if you're using more than one photograph. So A, B, C, D, and their coordinates have been mentioned, if you can see, and also the year in which they were taken. So title, source, and coordinates must be there in your photographs of the field. You cannot use your random pictures in which you are standing and clicking a selfie. Please avoid using such pictures in the field. Always remember, your pictures in the field must represent what you are trying to observe and identify. It should be fall in the context of your objectives of your study. All right, now if you're using a Google Earth image, so it must have that bottom tagline of which year the Google image was taken, and also it should be marked, as you can see in the image, that just don't click a screenshot and paste it. Remember, mark your images of the areas that you're representing specifically. As you can see, the images in this have been marked with red line. So mark it, then utilize for your reports. So that is the standard procedure of using a Google Earth map, right? You can use several field literature. For example, you can use newspaper cuttings, but remember, newspaper cuttings must have a date mentioned in their cuttings. So otherwise, that's not fair to use it. And it must have a title and source again. So title has to be what are you representing through the news, and the source have to be which newspapers. If it is more than one newspaper, mark it and write 1, 2, 3, 4 and the number of newspapers you have referred. But the news items must have date mentioned in somewhere or the other, right? Now, at the end, you can also make an areas of intervention map. So if you have a study area map or sketch, you can mark on that particular specific areas which you think that it has come up through your studies that those areas are needed attention for any strategy, for any decision making, for improvement. So you can mark those areas and specify through that image in the last part of your summary of your writing of report. So end part, the conclusive part of your report can have this strategies map or the areas of intervention map, because that would make sense to a reader that okay, this person has done this research and now she is providing this entire research into the framework of even making or formulating the strategies as suggested in the objectives part. So this is important to clearly mark out the particular areas of intervention or the areas of challenge or the areas where opportunities are there or threats are there. So anything, but it has to be marked clearly on the maps of the study area, right? So today we finished up the first part. In this session, we discussed about the tabulation and the representation of data, the basic idea behind it, the basic flow that is important for writing, what are the basic characteristics of writing a field report. So we completed the first section. So in the last section, the part 2, we are going to discuss about the conventions of report writing and the essential chapterization and the flows. So how are you going to design a report is going to be in the upcoming session. So please like and subscribe to our channel and please press the bell icon for the updates. And we are coming up with the next session with designing a field report. That is going to be the final session. So thank you so much.